One of the reasons, in my opinion, why the building management system industry is not evolving as fast as or advancing as fast as other industries is because we don't teach our managers and engineers advanced topics. I think in the past 3 years on this channel, we've discussed that to death. You know, we'll train our engineers on how to install a BMS and how to maintain a BMS. But we're not doing much more than that. There are so many other services, almost like consulting services, we could be offering to our customers, building owners, more than just installing the thing and keeping it running, fixing broken things. Over the years, I have created a lot of different types of training courses. I've created BMS training courses for facility managers, mechanical consultants, and of course, BMS engineers. And if I'm honest with you, you know, these are great courses, but they were still very hard to sell. And I think the reason why was that with training, just generally with any sort of training, you invest money in training, but it's very difficult to see a return on your investment. You spend money on training, but you don't really see your business profits increasing. And I think that's why training is always a difficult thing to get over the line. When I put together the advanced BMS maintenance course, I didn't start with what do service technicians need to know? Or what do building owners really want? Actually, the first version I did do that, but this version, what I did was I started with how can we make more money for BMS companies? And then I reverse engineered that into a course. What are the things that hold back the approval of fee proposals? What are those roadblocks? And I shifted them into the course. So although the technicians do learn technical things, like they'll learn, you know, how to troubleshoot network failures, but in between all those lessons and modules, I'm sprinkling in a lot of my consulting skills and the consulting services that building owners pay me to do. I'm teaching BMS companies how to do what I do. And if, like, in a way, this course, it's like an investment program or an investment plan for BMS companies. It's like putting money in the bank, except the interest isn't 2%, the interest is thousands of percent over a 10-year cycle. When I started putting together the structure for the course, I gave myself three KPIs. There were three things that I had to achieve in the development of this program. The first one was that BMS companies must make money, and they need to make more than 10 times the amount of money they invest in the training. If you have technicians going to large sites or you have lots of sites, you're gonna make 100 times more than the program. That was the first thing I had to do. The second thing I had to do was we have to rebuild the trust between building owners and the BMS industry or BMS companies, because they are not gonna pay us more money unless they're happy with the current engagement, which is the 12-month maintenance contract. So during the 12 weeks, we have to start repairing that trust. And the intention here is that after 12 weeks or so, the building owners and the FMs will start to think, something is a bit different here. There's a different vibe here. So that's the second thing I had to work out. And the third thing was that BMS service technicians need to be happy. They need to be engaged. Because if we don't have a highly motivated workforce, this isn't gonna work. This program is going to dramatically raise the profile of BMS service technicians. They are the heroes of the future. The failure of most training courses is that nothing happens after the training course. You know, I've taught a lot of engineers really amazing things. They've enjoyed the courses, got their certificate, and off they go. I don't think that they're going out there and taking the knowledge that I gave them and converting it into money and value. I don't think it's happening. So in this version of the course, a big change in this version is that both the service technician and myself, we are both accountable to deliverables at the end of the course. We have to deliver something in the course, and this is what it is. During the program, as we work through the different lessons, and I say, okay, in preparation for next week's lesson, go and find this out on your site and come back. Let's have a look what you got. So through the course, we find a whole bunch of opportunities specific to that site, and we document them in the opportunities schedule. We create this list of things that can be done. All sorts of things, server upgrades, network upgrades, controller upgrades, cybersecurity upgrades, energy management systems, building analytics, energy efficiency, optimization. We just start writing these things down in a big schedule. And then we take that list of stuff and we spread it out into a 10-year capital expenditure plan. We need the money here, here, here. This is how much money we need. This is where we need it. Because this gives building owners advance notice that in 5 years' time, we need $1 million over a 3-year project to upgrade 1,000 obsolete field controllers. We have to give owners notice. And that's the biggest breakdown of what we do. We ask for money in the year that we need the money. It's not there. The money's not there. We didn't ask for it. It's not budgeted for. The FM didn't go to the fund managers to get the money released in advance. The planning didn't happen. I'm going to show you how to do that. For example, this year in October, Microsoft will stop support for Windows Server 2012. So 3 years ago, we should have had that in our CapEx plan, telling the facility manager to organize us $50,000 for this year. So we 3 years ago, first touch point with our customer, oh, by the way, this is coming up. Let's get into capital expenditure plan, rough numbers. Last year, October, we should have given them a fixed fee proposal. No surprise to them, they know about it because we've been talking about it for a couple of years. This year in January, we get a purchase order. We order the hardware, the servers, we get everything geared up. In July, August, September, we do the server upgrade. We made it. That's how this works. That's how planning works. This is what consultants do. This is what I'm going to teach you how to do. To ask for $50,000 in the same year you need the money, you're not going to get that money. It's not available. And also, while I'm sort of rambling a bit here, the facility manager might not want to go to the building owner and say, Mr. Building Owner, sorry, I haven't been doing my job properly. I've just found out that we need an emergency upgrade of the server. Please, can I have $50,000? It's embarrassing for them. There's lots of reasons why you will not get the money if you don't ask for it long in advance. How many buildings do you have in your service department? How many service contracts do you have? How many buildings do you do maintenance on? 20 buildings, 50 buildings, 100 buildings. And what is the complete end of life replacement cost to completely replace that BMS after, say, 20 years? What's that complete end of life replacement cost for all of your sites? What's that number? 10 million, 50 million, 100 million? That money is money we're leaving on the table. Because if you are the incumbent BMS company, you should be getting those end of life upgrades if we do the right thing. And that is the minimum amount of money that we should be earning through service small projects, because the end of life replacement cost for all of your sites doesn't include that, in a 20-year cycle, the server's probably gonna be upgraded 3 times. The network controllers are gonna be upgraded twice, cybersecurity upgrades, network upgrades, energy management system stuff, building analytics stuff. It doesn't include control strategy optimization and energy efficiency, which is needed to support buildings' energy efficiency rating systems, net zero, all the stuff that's coming through. It doesn't include any of that. What is that number for your entire portfolio as the BMS company over a 20-year cycle? That is what we can earn. We are not making it easy for our customers to engage with us. It sounds ridiculous saying that. We as BMS companies are not making it easy for our customers to give us money. I can't believe I'm saying that, but it is the case. See down in the YouTube description box below for more details on the advanced BMS maintenance program. It starts tomorrow. By the time you listen to this, you've missed the first group. But I've just been through, it takes about 3 months to get lifecycle controls approved on a large BMS company's supplier list, to get approvals from the state managers, then the national managers, then the regional managers. I've just been through this with one of the manufacturers. And then we're going to choose which service technician is going to do the course. That's a 3-month process. So let's start talking about it now for the next round. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next one.